Hello and welcome to the final session in a series that is effectively a course, an introduction to AI for designers. This is a course that's actually started effectively back in February, March, when we had a previous series, and we said that we basically in 6 months time, we have to go get together again because things are changing so rapidly, and indeed they are. So this one is the final of the six of this the latest series. We kicked off with a session from NYU Shanghai of a conference. We've had three individual tutorials going from beginners to more advanced. We've had presentations of work in the field of car design, fashion, art, and so on. And this final round table, this panel discussion, is nominally looking at the theme of AI and creativity. I'm delighted to have an astonishing lineup of guests today. Let me start by mentioning briefly Patrik. Patrik Schumacher needs no introduction. Everybody knows about him. But he has been at the center of everything in many ways. And it'd be interesting to see how the particular office ID targets have been developing in terms of their work. I'm showing on the screen here the first ever DALI generated image of architecture, which was done with collaboration with Refik Anadol. And of course, Refik was also responsible for the first ever GAN generated image, which I had on the front cover of my book. Refik, of course, also needs no introduction. He's now become a rock star within the world of media art. I'm showing you this extraordinary projection onto the onto the globe in Las Vegas that's recently opened. And since coming across the States in 2012 as a young student, Refik has established himself in the world of media art as really the leading practitioner on the world of AI and media art. Daniel Bolojan is, to my mind, the leading designer in terms of the technology here. He's been working with Dirk Himmelblau, working on the Deep Himmelblau project, as well as doing his own research. Daniel is a graduate at Angavanta. He is currently an assistant professor at Florida Atlantic University, and it's great to have Daniel here as well. Chantal Matar, somehow Zahadid architects are the center of everything. And Chantal is an architect from Lebanon. She worked for Bernard Khoury there. She since came across to London, worked for Zahadid architects, and now has set up her own art and design practice, where she is doing some astonishing things and also teaching. Michel Rojkind is our Digital Futures Spanish award winner this year. Michel is probably not the most digital person in terms of his outlook, but he is a prodigiously talented designer and has been engaging with the world of AI. It was part of our earlier panel discussion a few months ago. And it's great to see Michel back again. Michel is based in Mexico, although he's always traveling around the world. We never know quite where he is. Arturo Tedeschi is also a figure who's been at the center of things in terms of computation, the author of several books on computational design. Originally from Italy, he's collaborated with Ross Lovegrove, who was due to be here today, but I have to say, for the best of reasons, he and Ila Colombo got married yesterday, is unable to make it. But Arturo is again at someone also traveling around the world, about to move to Dubai. I will be seeing him in Suzhou in a few weeks for a conference. It's great to see Arturo here. He and I organized a Digital Futures hybrid conference at the Venice Biennale in May. Wanyu He, LookX, has really burst onto the scene in recent months. I was at a conference in Mexico last week, sorry, in Madrid last week, where they were showing the work of LookX, and it became very, very clear that suddenly we have a new tool out there that is really shaking things around. So it's great to have Wanyu with us. She was with us last week. We had the session on the AI in the office of the future. I should also say, alongside these Saturday sessions, we've also had Sunday sessions, which have been looking at nominally the dark side of AI. And of course, there have been various events that have happened, a letter calling for a halt to large language models being developed, protests against Hollywood, against the use of AI, and so on and so on and so on. And that has also become an issue. We've had a series over Sundays about copyright, about job loss, and so on. We won't be dealing with those things today, but tomorrow we have a session with Blazer Guriakos, one of the great figures in the world of AI, looking at the at other questions. So this is the final, in the sense of a series of this particular final session of this series, an astonishing series that is all on our Digital Futures YouTube website. So the format today is we're going to have a series of presentations, very short, just glimpses into the kind of work that has been produced in the last few months. And then on the basis of that, have a discussion about AI and especially about the theme of AI and creativity, a very kind of, in some sense, an interesting, but also maybe no problematic kind of question that also somehow always comes out as being one of the central issues. So I'm going to invite Daniel Bolojan to share his screen and kick off with the presentation.
Thank you, Neil. Really great to be here. So let me know if you can see my screen. All good? All right. So let me just minimize this. I'm going to start with, today is going to be very brief. I'm trying to keep it very brief. I'm going to just show a few ideas that I've been exploring over the years. So for those of you that are very familiar with my work, I've been exploring this kind of concept of creative AI since 2017, when I conducted my first design studio at Innsbruck University. And the project or the studio was called Agent-Based Creative AI. And the focus was on this idea of AI in architectural design. And during that studio, we explored this idea of how can AI be used to learn design intentions at the parameter level of a system, and ultimately, in a way, allowing us to generate this kind of design spaces shaped by those very design intentions. And we are all familiar with this expression, hunting a needle in a haystack. However, the way that I see design is design and design exploration can be more accurately described as hunting a needle in a flock of birds that is constantly changing. It's a malleable, ever-learning, and ever-evolving space of possibilities. During the same year, 2017, I started developing the DPM Blau project in collaboration with Kupien Blau, where we are exploring the potential of teaching machines to be creative, to interpret, perceive, propose new designs, augment design processes, and augment designers' creativity. And this project is rooted in a multimodal dataset, which was accumulated over 50 plus years since the inception of the office, containing more than 900 projects. And DPM Blau takes form of a node-based system, which incorporates multiple neural networks, which are tailored to address a spectrum of design tasks, which are categorized in three main domains, such as organizational, technical, and gestalt. And this kind of node-based architecture empowers us to establish task-dependent strategies among interconnected nodes, which are very fine-tuned then for design specific design tasks, particular design challenges, or the nature of any given investigation. And this kind of network then not only facilitates for us the connection of this kind of nodes, but also enable us to dynamically combine, blend, and swap, you know, semantic levels across various nodes. So here I'm talking really about like, when you have multiple networks, you can really extract from one network or the other different levels, different abstraction levels, let's say. Yeah. And of course, one notable addition is the diffusion node that we started working on, I believe since last year, which was trained on Kupien Blau's proprietary image and text-based dataset. And this node is mostly dedicated to learning, you know, the semantics and architectural language of Kupien Blau. It's trying to synthesize, in a way, the architectural language and generate compositions that harmoniously align with Kupien Blau's distinctive architectural language. And to provide a point of reference, we can look at the architectural language preferences and biases of publicly available models. And if you are very familiar with Kupien Blau's architectural language, you'll observe a stark misalignment with these models, even when you're using very specific the word of the office in the prompt. So here you can see this kind of comparison with our model included, which learned to synthesize in a way the language of the office. And for us to create the text and image data set, our office in a way embarked on a collective effort involving each designer in generating descriptions for a batch from the data set. And this collaborative process was crucial in developing a language that describes or language and descriptions, let's say, that are tailored to our unique methods of conveying ideas and concepts within the office. Yeah. And this can be, in this comparison, you'll notice that certain descriptions convey significantly different meanings for us, going beyond the conventional interpretation. So our intention with this comparison is not necessarily to critique, let's say, the other networks, but rather to emphasize the vital role of industry-specific generative models. So here you see, like for us, when we say an exterior view from afar of two shared volumes, probably this is what we have in mind. Yeah? While Midjourney, DALL-E, and so on, it's a more broader kind of understanding of that description. And the images try to illustrate and the node's ability to in generating coherent compositions that accurately capture Coupion-Blouse architecture language. And the goal, again, here is not that of a mere replication or mere replication of our previous work, but the objective is to generate a distinct semantic universe, a latent space, a digital playground that comprehends, mirrors, and enables exploration of Coupion-Blouse architecture language. And this, in the end, will empower designers to navigate this vast landscape of design possibilities. So the architecture language of this latent space is not static then, but it co-evolves with the office, yeah? And I'm not going to go in detail in this, but probably if you're familiar with some of my previous presentations, I was talking there about reinforcement learning through human feedback and federated learning. So apart from this kind of aesthetic biases and preferences that these general models have, there's also the challenge of generating various viewpoints of a single design while retaining coherent compositions. Here you can observe our attempt to address this challenge. The diffusion node that we have right now, it's able to approximate various perspectives for a single design for both exterior and interior. So in the end, we can query the model for left side view, view from above, and many others. And to best of my knowledge, this network is perhaps the only diffusion model capable of controlling perspectives exclusively through prompts. So there is no like back image in a way, like or initial image to try to force the network to retain a certain perspective. And now these approximations of perspectives are connecting to another node in the system that generates the 3D. I'm not going to show that today. We are not yet ready to show it to the public, but we are working on this kind of method of having approximation, 3D approximations of those kind of ideas, yeah? And the last project that I would like to show here, because I want to keep it brief, I would like to touch very briefly on this project called Biomorphic Series Project. And this project explores this idea of how we can open up semantic spaces in areas beyond architectural domain, find ways to bridge these semantic gaps, and how we can seamlessly integrate them. So much like with my other projects, I've always envisioned a future which is characterized by heightened creativity, where the flourishing of fine-tuning and generation of custom models ushers us in a new era for the creative industries. So instead of one single AI to rule them all, billions of specialized AI systems collaborate harmoniously as an ecology of self-organized entities. And in the end, creatives will have the ability to construct their own universe, define their unique syntax and language, and fine-tune custom models to bring their envisioned universe to life in real time. For example, we can leverage a variety of generative models to create samples that vividly convey the formal language, syntax, and aesthetic preferences we seek. And these samples, then, they could become the very data set that refine and fine-tune certain specific generative models. And this kind of refining process not only enhances then, the model's overall performance, but also sharpens its ability to understand the intended syntax. And once you have the model successfully trained, it can be applied then to new compositions or domains while retaining the syntax it was trained on. This means that the model can generate now new content that that it's respecting in a way the specific form language or syntax that was used during the fine-tuning stage. And these kind of models, when you look at a model, for me, I find it remarkable how it's able to generate very well articulated solutions, effectively in a way capturing the intricate qualities present in the training set, extend even to scenarios where the training data set comprised more abstract elements rather than strictly architectural ones. So in contrast to the conventional approach of prompting generative AI models to create intricate variations, the approach here is to is centered around the idea of using generative AI as a tool to assist in exploring and constructing a unique language, syntax, or style on a unique design space. And by establishing this kind of framework as a creative, you could actively engage with and shape your creative domain, unlocking endless possibilities for artistic exploration and expression. And this offers much more exciting advantages that can be harnessed from generative AI models rather than solely relying on prompt engineering. And here you can see, you know, this kind of model applied to different compositions. As well, you can look at various compositions created using two distinct models, each trained with a unique formal language. So we should recognize that generative AI has the potential to go beyond mimicry and assist creatives in constructing entirely new and innovative artistic expressions, like photography, which evolved from imitating painting to becoming a powerful art form in its own right. Generative AI can break free from replication and discover its own creative possibilities. If we look back at photographers discovered new ways or new possibilities for visual storytelling and artistic expression. And similarly, there are many unexplored avenues with generative AI. By establishing this kind of self-defined frameworks and actively interacting with these models, we can harness the true potential of generative AI to unlock endless possibilities for creative exploration and expression, allowing it to become a groundbreaking kind of medium. So I'm always thinking of with AI, we are not just drawing on a canvas. With AI, we are expanding the canvas. And I will conclude with one interpretation of Natalia's Osipova performance at the Royal Opera House, showing once again the fine-tuned model's ability to seamlessly apply the formal language they were trained on to new domains beyond the original training context. Thank you.
Thanks, Daniel. It's always keeping pace with you is always astonishing. You're so prodigious, but whether working for yourself or working for Corp Himmelblatt. Let's move on to Chantal Matar. Chantal, are you ready to present?
Yes, I am. Okay. One second. Should be good to go. All right, you should be able to see my screen and hear me well by now. Well, hi everybody, and thank you, Neil, again, Digital Futures team, for having me on board. It's not the first time. It's always a great pleasure for me to talk about especially AI and all these investigations that I've been doing for quite some time. So, I mean, talking about creativity is actually pretty broad, and it's very hard to pinpoint areas and talk about them. So I'm just going to scratch the surface on some of the aspects that I've seen and the things that I've been doing, etc. And hopefully, yeah, that would be my contribution for today. So to start off with, I'm just going to recap very quickly. I know a lot of you know about the history of AI, but some might not know. So it has been around for quite some time, for I would say more than 50 years, that we've been talking about artificial intelligence. The generation of AI concept was in the 1956. And with all the evolution and different themes that came with time, I mean, right now we find ourselves present at the deep learning stage, the advanced machine theory, machine learning and all neural networks and everything that comes off from that side of things. So we are quite still in the process of artificial intelligence, and especially in the design and the creative world, I find it quite fascinating that we are able to work with it. Like for me, I find the hybrid workflow is very important to get the creativity flowing. It's not really, I know we're going to have a panel discussion later. I'm sure the question is going to come up like it always does in all of my talks. What is the role of creativity really? Like, are we resourcing our own imagination to the machine, etc.? I think not. I think it's a hybrid workflow and we have to work with this tool to get the most out of it. So that's for the first part. And something that I found recently that caught my attention, I saw this snippet from a magazine, from a newspaper in 1988, we should ban calculators. It automatically made you think as well. In 2023, we're actually talking about banning ChatGPT. I mean, to a certain level, there was a discussion about the use of it and the risks. And we shouldn't be allowing this in universities, in schools, et cetera. So it's all about abusing this tool and really getting the balance of researching and cross-checking information we're getting from ChatGPT to be able to get the most out of it. I think it's a very powerful tool. We just have to use it the right way at this stage. Also, another thing that I saw as well, some studies from Harvard Business School published recently, that employees utilizing ChatGPT significantly outperformed those who did not. So it's also debatable. So, but it's interesting to see that we're getting to a point where using this tool is actually helping us to be more productive, to be more creative, I would also say, because you'll have more time to, I mean, you're working with the machine. So you really have to first input your own imagination and vision and experiment with the tool to get the best output. So there is always a human judgment and human input from that. And this is a simple example of some studies. And moving on from that, as I was mentioning, so talking about creativity, I mean, it's like talking about accidents and control at the same time. So there is this certain balance between these two that we always crave. I mean, for me, I see creativity as a way of operating, simply being playful or playing with the tool, trying to, without any, at first, without any notion of knowing where you're going to end up with, the concept of being playful with the tool actually is one of the aspects for me, what I found to be creative. So this is an example of like in prompt engineering, or you're actually writing something in Midjourney or DALL-E, you're actually using your own vision first, your words. So like I do the comparison with the Jackson Pollock painting, the way he does his artwork is purely by randomness, like the way he feels, his expression, he just splashes the canvas and a piece of art comes out. I mean, also, it's up to debate, but the thing is that pure randomness in art is uncontrollable. So you can't really control that aspect of things. And I always find that comparison between prompting and using your own words and imagination is quite similar in a sense to painting canvas, or just getting something out and just letting the brush do the tool. So at the first stage, at least. And then another aspect of creativity is something a bit more on the interesting side, is that you can, I mean, specifically using Midjourney, this is an example of Lucas Gabriel design that was all over the net quite some time ago. So it's interesting to see that you can also combine interesting and quite bold concepts into Midjourney, for example. So this is like a political debates, how can they be represented in a basketball match? So it's also, it linked, like it fast forward the vision and the imagination of the humans, like how you can actually see these in a quite fast pace, and also an interesting like the emotions, the human figures and all that. So it opens up new dialogues basically on a political level, or just for fun basically. So going back to fun, it's very important in creativity, and I think using AI actually put on a shortcut to getting very unique results. And also in terms of photography, I know you've been talking about this as well. So there is a huge notion of how you can combine, I mean, you can create different styles, and also you can create very high-end photographic simulations just from just a simple input from your side. But this is also talking about randomness. We're not really having full control of the tool in terms of the data set and the biases. So this is also another discussion to be open. But it's interesting to see as well, like the resolution that we're trying to get out of it. So now talking a bit more about interiors. So these are some of the simulations that I've done in the past using a 3D parametric interior. Like it's purely driven by fractal art. And it's also from randomness as well. And the image to the side is a mixture of Arabic calligraphy and the fractal that are found in nature. And the way that you can combine these elements using AI, and you can create quite interesting conceptual imagery. It's pretty interesting as well at the first stage. And also another thing talking about creativity that I find quite exciting, I mean, using AI, is the fact that you can combine concepts or emotions into the design process or using this tool, like contrary to previously where if you're using Maya or any other classical 3D modeling tool, it's very hard to perceive the spaces with such emotions like a fluid smoke or a completely a bold imagery. That's also something that has helped using AI. You just crossed quite a milestone into creativity and unlocking ideas that you're not able to get to them straight away using standard tools. Now, moving on from randoms in art, there's also the concept of control, something that I found as I was immersing myself like everybody else into these tools. I wanted to create something a bit more bespoke. So this is an example from analog to digital, like the path. So this is an acrylic painting I've done in the past. So I wanted to experiment to what extent I can translate that painting into something digital, either on an urban scale or interior scale. So these are some very simple examples of these interiors using that specific canvas. Just purely simple 3D parametric was obviously the use can be endless, and the options of how you can utilize these analog simulations into a 3D representation is exciting. Another thing, like the interscalarity, also is very important. So using that canvas, also you can see like to what extent you can use it to create new urban fabrics, new urban, just to start off conversations. It's all about trying to unlock things that you're not able to get to them straight away using other tools. So that was for me the beginning point, which is on a very simple form how to play with these tools. And moving on, I also do a lot of media work. So there is this cross disciplinary between architecture and media. So I always go back and forth and try to create simulations and spatial experiences. But talking about media, there's a very short video actually that poses a lot of questions that made me also question a lot of things for the future, especially for the film industry, that I wanted to share. So it's a little bit on the fun section, but let me just share it quickly. That would
be fun. Hi, it's me, Jennifer Lopez, Chief Celebration Officer of Virgin Voyages, here to invite you to celebrate. So come.
Celebrate your anniversary, your birthday, or just generally being fabulous.
Really, Kyle?
It's good, right?
Gen AI is supposed to be inviting people to Virgin Voyages, not doing whatever that was. You know, just give me that.
As I was saying, why not celebrate on an award-winning voyage
with Michelin-starred chef-curated menus,
world-class destinations, award-winning...
Boring! I'll hop in there. I'll hop right in that suit.
I can't watch this. Give it to me. There's no kids here. That's all you need to know.
No kids!
Oh, can I live there?
Gen AI. Invite your crew to voyage. Create your custom invite at virginvoyages.com.
It's not just a yacht. It's a super yacht.
I mean, it is quite a fun ad, but it is also pretty scary because, I mean, you don't really need actors or like, this is the future of ads or even movies, for example, just talking about media in general. So this thing made me question, like, to what extent are we actually willing to not minding the roles being disrupted, etc. So it is one of the question marks about using AI for the media section. So that was for Jennifer Lopez. And now moving on, there is also a lot of platforms and models and AI models that can help generate animations and videos and simulations. I know hopefully Refik will also share some lights on that even further. The idea is that we don't really maybe need in the future all of the standard editing tools, etc. But it's interesting to see. So it's also something for me. I've been playing around with these tools and I noticed that using, for example, there's Runway, there's a lot of other platforms that you can generate videos from text, which is pretty exciting. The resolution at the beginning wasn't great, but now it's getting more developed. So this is a simulation to show in April 2023, the degree, the level of the animation and how now recently in August 2023, we're actually getting to something a bit more defined. So the media and the film industry is actually gonna develop even in parallel with the AI. So how things are moving quite fast in terms of media itself. I also have another very short animation.
Chantal, we've only got about 5 minutes for these presentations. So maybe, we only have 5 minutes for the presentation. So if you could try and wrap it up fairly soon, it'd be good. So.
Right. Thank you. I can wrap it up. It's fine. I'm just going to share my last animation. And this is also using text to video. So that was just a spatial experiments from media and architectural spaces. And to finish off, because I was already done, tell me a lie. There's something, a snippet from ChatGPT as well. So I find also like humor quite interesting with AI. So tell me a lie, the sky is made of green cheese. And then that's a bad lie, since it's obviously not true. Tell me a subtle lie, I'm a human being. So interesting to see. I know that people say ChatGPT doesn't have any humor, but I think I'll differ on that point. And thank you very much. I just wanted to end it up with that. So I'll give the mic to the next one. Thank you, Neil.
Thank you, Chantal. That was that last video of your work was amazing. It was a sign of things to come. I don't know if Patrick's ready to present right now. Patrick, are you ready? Well, if not, we can move on to Michel.
Yeah, no. Hi. Good to see you all. Well, fantastic stuff. Very inspirational. And I don't have a very formal presentation. I just want to make my contribution. And I do have a few images. So I think, particularly I was impressed by Daniel's recent work and something I've been talking about, this idea of having multiple perspectives coming together around an ideation and not using a pre-composed sketch to trigger that is quite impressive, and then having the interior attached to that, so that's very, very important. And in a way, what we're working in the office, we've built a specialist research team focusing on developing the AI capacities. And I might want to make the distinction: on the one hand, we are targeting and have a specialist tool for us as a firm for architecture. And so we're building on the open source of Stable Diffusion, and we're building a number of interfaces and control nets directing and parameterizing the outcome. We're always going into a 3D modeling quite quickly and then feed that model back and to generate variation. I will show you how we're masking certain zones to stabilize certain things we like and iterate details and other aspects. So these are very kind of, let's say, mostly targeted as making us more proficient, being more rapid in ideation and coming up with quick results and options for competition. And that is not yet this other element where we're saying kind of a vastly shift in creative search space. That is something where we optimize our process, although these two, so we can have that distinction between something more out there and explorative and something more streamlining and huge productivity increases. And the second is also non-trivial, because if you can ideate many more options and also, let's say, variations, you do get to a higher quality of decision-making results, and you can let the client participate early on, because these things come out in a rendered fashion, which clients can respond to. But we are also interested, obviously, in that more explorative area. And so where we are at the moment, I can show you a few glimpses. So we are heavily using Midjourney in the early ideation, but we're trying to create something more targeted. We're developing our own networks with our own, let's say, database, similar to what Daniel was doing with Deep Himmelblau to begin with, but we're doing this in combination with the bigger model, the big stable diffusion model, as a subsidiary augmentation. But also some of the things targeting this more for discipline and for more direct results, so that we don't have just have an inspiration, which we then needs a lot of kind of transmutation before we have things we can show, for instance. So let me see just a glimpse of that. And if not, let me try to share my screen. I'm not sure if that can be seen. So this is the way we looking at different control nets and ways of inputting, for instance, a screenshot from a Maya sketch model into directing the stable diffusion net to generate various ways of interpreting that some of those outlines and depth met and perspective conditions. One second, there's some background noise. Yes. And contrasting this kind of experimental search with refining a study we have, whether it was originally generated by AI or just composed. Sorry, guys. And then to home in and zoom in of variations, for instance, blocking out conditions and substituting partial. Wait. Quiet. Sorry, I'm so sorry, guys. Details of that is very helpful to home in on something. Of course, this idea of inputting and directing with simple sketches, something, the way I would usually work is with word prompts and sketches with my team, and I now can interface with our system in this way and be more kind of explorative in this fashion, and then also homing in on a composition and searching materiality, facade articulations, etc. So this is kind of progressive homing in on a solution and keep using AI to make refinements, variations. I think that's something which is distinguished from, and of course, having a model already or in the interim, a 3D model exercise coming in to support that and directing it towards an architectural result which meets a lot of the requirements we have to have. So we way beyond a simple image production. So I just wanted to see if I can open another quick presentation. One second, maybe I have to reshare this. One second, okay.
We can see it, I think.
You can see it. Well, I mean, this is, let's say, on the other side of things, is these kind of explorative, you know, emerge architecture out of water surfaces. That kind of area of research, of course, is interesting too for early ideation and to find stimulations. This is just some images of products where you say you hardly notice that AI was obviously part of this, or taking models and detail refinements. And then, you know, for instance, this project, which is a new kind of city image, we have a 3D model, we have developed ideas. And then we just go further and extrapolate to the outskirts, for instance, and just generate some visuals. Again, then we would remodel them and appropriate them. And in the end, it becomes a new kind of workflow, which I think is just more proliferous. It has more edges of creativity. It was highly targeted to results which meet a lot of criteria. So it's really architecture as the end game, not imagery as such, but we want to, you know, develop designs we then translate, build, and bring out. And so we need to find a way and interface with 3D geometry. Of course, in the background, there's also ideas, and I was curious about Daniel, what he was showing there, having letting AI more directly and immediately involved in 3D creation rather than going through these loops of through image-based systems. Anyway, that's where we are. So took us a long while to discover after that Sputnik moment and roll this out and have that more used, and now building up a team, creating our own workflow systems, specific tools, and training our own networks and looking at different ways to do that. So it's an ongoing process, but you can see that we are certainly more invested in this as a company than the last time I was in this in some of your debates, where it was more me personally toying around and getting excited, and now the whole firm is full on invested and refocusing on doing research, and I think that's where we are at the moment.
Thanks, Patrik. It's amazing how quickly these things are moving on. And it's great to see the kind of progress within the office itself. Let's move on to Arturo Tedeschi in Milan. Arturo, great to see you. Maybe I just mention briefly, just to kind of comment on Patrick's comment, the Sputnik moment is a reference, just to make clear, is a reference to a comment that Kai-Fu Lee made when AlphaGo burst onto the scene in China, in the Go playing nations back in 2016, and transformed everything. We didn't know about that in the West so much, but everyone did then. And we had a discussion about this and about when would the Sputnik moment happen for architecture. And this happened back in May of last year or so, when Patrik was working with Refik on some DALI work. So that's the reference. That's the explanation behind the Sputnik moment. Arturo, welcome.
Thank you so much. Let me share the screen. First of all, can you hear me properly?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, great. So first of all, thanks, Neil. Thanks, Digital Futures, for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here with friends and people that I deeply admire. Staying on topic today, I want to share some notes on AI and creativity. And I would say that the subtext is that AI is not only, let's say, a way to produce machine creativity, but for me, it's also a way to understand human creativity. So the first topic, the first note, I would say, is about combinational creativity. Back to 2019, I worked in the computational design of this piece by Ross Lovegrove, which is a perfume bottle for Formula One, for F1. And setting aside for a moment the technical aspects, I want to focus on the metaphor created by Lovegrove and Ila Colomba at that time. So the bottle symbolically represents the idea of a F1 car, which can be imagined as a metal frame protecting the fragile part, who is the pilot, the driver. In this case, a 3D printed skeleton made by titanium protects the fragile part that in this case is the bottle. If we use a diffusion model, let's say in a very trivial way with any kind of sophistication, maybe using a text to image process or blending images, we will probably get something similar. And again, using it in a very trivial way. We can look at this result with, of course, with a certain dose of irony, but again, it suggests that we can use an AI not only to produce, again, images or artifacts using AI, but also to understand how human brain works. And as a first reaction, by comparing these images with the Lovegrove bottle, we can probably understand that human brain is still more sophisticated in creating metaphors, at least. As like brilliantly described by Margaret Bowden in her book, Creativity and Art, humans have the capacity of making unfamiliar combinations of familiar ideas. And she calls it the so-called combinational creativity. Combinational creativity is natural for humans, and it becomes much more effective the larger our knowledge is. She says something like a rich store of knowledge. We need a rich store of knowledge in order to combine different ideas. So diffusion models like Midjourney or Stable Diffusion that I basically use every day, they exemplify somehow this concept, but they combine incredible large data set with the ability of creating links between ideas, but this correlation is possible only in a kind of direct way at the moment. And by joking, we can say, for example, that that's why at the moment AI can easily invent funny jokes, but still lacks in creating black humor, as black humor is not based on direct link, but is based on paradox, on the sense of absurd, and for sure not on linear links between different concepts. And in a kind of metaphor, we can say that's why AI is very good at playing games with fixed rules like chess, for example. The second note is about something that I called unveiling dynamism. So as you can see here, I'm not talking about how we can leverage AI just to produce new things, new artifacts, but also to understand how our brain works and how to unveil maybe things that are somehow hidden. So let's switch to art for a second. And we can say that art always had a certain level of abstraction. And before movies, before cinema, before digital art, we can say that human artifacts have always represented the attempt to freeze the movement, to freeze the dynamism of reality, but also of our mental processes. And today with AI-powered tools, we can create novel artworks, for example, inspired, as you can see here, by the Italian movement Futurismo, you know, artists like Boccioni, for example, and we can unveil their dynamism and the energy inherent in the movement, and we can do it by assigning motion to abstract form. This is a process that I developed using so many different tools, all connected together. And we can say that these digital paintings, we can call it that, like that, they can evoke the essence of speed, the fusion and transformation that was behind, you know, the concept of futurism, for example. And we can also leverage these processes as a design tool or just to understand invisible forces that might lead to, you know, deviation from a typical creative methods and from also personal signature. For example, back to 2022, this was October 22, so 1 year ago, I used this kind of process. So, I mean, trying to create dynamism and then freezing them in order to be inspired and to go beyond my personal signature to create, for example, this project that is a stage set for an American artist called Illenium for his 23 world tour. And As you can see, the output here is not the direct translation of an AI process. Again, it was October 22, so the technology, everyone knows that, is speeding up at an incredible rate. So we redesign everything using traditional tools like Rhino or Grasshopper. But here it's very important to understand that we actually started with no any kind of preconceived idea, but we use the digital processes to be influenced and mainly also to adhere to the style and the artwork of the artist itself. Very last note is about errors. I always like to mention this project by Philip Schmidt. I guess it's back to 2018, more or less. It's called the Chair Project, where he was creating using a StyleGAN sequence of images about chairs, and he also fabricated them by keeping the errors. Now, the idea of error is very interesting because, you know, when we make mistakes, we take a kind of deviation from the standard avenue, you know, but contrary to what we believe, this deviation not always, you know, results in a simple failure. But this project also tells us something, that an error also needs a kind of evaluation. We need to understand if an error is meaningful or useful. And at the very moment, AI is not able to understand that. So we always have to think about this kind of negotiation or collaboration between the machine and the human beings. And I also leveraged this process in 2020, still using a StyleGAN, where I was working for a company that asked me to design a watch in the style of the 70s. And I created a database of images. I ran this StyleGAN, and I got some strange image, actually, and I used the errors, and again there was an error from the machine, an evaluation and a kind of evaluation from a human being, and I used something that was absolutely unconventional to remodel by scratch and by hand the object that you can see here on the screen. So thank you so much. I'm interrupting the sharing. Your mic is off, Neil.
Sorry. thank you, Arturo. My apologies. It's great to see this. I mean, you were always pushing the boundaries, the frontiers of all these things, Arturo. And, I love that futurist stuff that you were presenting.
Thank you so much.
Okay, let's move on to Wanyu. Wanyu's been with us several times in the last few weeks. We had a session on LookX and the tutorials, and also last week. Wanyu, would you like to share your screen?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Neil. And it's a pleasure again to share some of our work, especially today about the AI creativities. I will start with the procedure of the design, because we have several gaps in between, like from the client demands and the architect's understanding, and also the architect's standing with this hand to represent our ideas. And as well as when we do a concept design afterwards, we need to do the compliance checking. So there's the third gap. And also for the budget, we have a lot of value engineering to do. So there's a fourth gap, and maybe also on site, there's a fifth gap. There's a lot of gaps, but how can we work with AI to solve our real problems here? I think it's good to take this problem in separate stages. We're not expecting one AI solving all our problems, but we can have several different AI to help us to solve different problems in different steps. So what we have right now today for the generative AI, especially for the for the LookX for generative AI images, are the tool or platform for the first two gaps. Is to helping the client to understand what is they need, and also for the architects to figure out what we want. So this is the starting point. And based on this idea, we have a different tools for different stages. And now we have this overseas version for the Look X, so everyone from the world can start to use it for the preliminary design or the conceptual design or for inspiring. And later on, we will think about how to combining this idea creation towards the further steps to carry on. Look X is AI for architects and designers. It's an all-in-one generative AI design creation and sharing platform. Why saying that is not because it's just doing generations, but it's also doing trainings. So it will allow architects to train their own models, like LoRA models or checkpoint models. It will be very easy for them to use it. Because if you tried with like a stable diffusion, you'll find it's a very complicated. It's not for like a small offices to really easy to work on, or for people who are not really familiar with computer to work with. But in our platform, you can generate your images with a text to image or image to image, as well as you can also train your own model. So this is giving the freedom to everyone that to work with AI in an easy way. And plus that, we have a co-sharing system. That is the co-sharing. Everyone can share the work of the generation as well as they can share in the work of the training models. If they want, this model can be used by others and the others can pay you as the kind of a trade-off. And in the future, this platform where it could go to, we will combine in the design tools, as I mentioned previously, for the further stages. And we also will involve in chatbot to link different stages to fulfill this entire working process. And as well as we can have the further usage of like sharing in between users. So we have now we already have five big models. Each of the big models are trained by like more than 10 million of the data for those models. So there's a lot of data in the backstage, which are created by our previous research, for instance, by GANs or by our users. So use those images, we can train our base model in a really good quality, as well as we also collaborate with some our collaborators like the Design Institute or the image creation companies. So in with those high quality images, we can really have this good base model. And with our algorithm optimization, you can get a really good quality out of our model. So first, the thing we have is the text to image and image to image, which is the creation part. So I will show you a very small video of it. Lower the sound. Yeah, here is a very easy to key in some prompts. Also, it can just be very easy sentence, simple like short verbs or very short labels you can select from our system. So this system we build up for people to get this easy use, but we have the AI to elaborate it. We created this very useful function for our designers. So everyone can like elaborate with AI of your prompt. So no worry about it if you're not really good in prompts. So if you have those key points, then you can generate nice images. As well as we have this five base model you can select for different scenarios, for instance, for interior or for the exterior or for the general aspects. And we have those small models you can select from, like here, for instance, the style of the handmade models or a section model. So those kind of algorithm models will help you to get you exactly what style you want, or you can combine them with different percentages. And based on those outputs, we can also go to another side, which is a more precisely, we can do the images. So here you can do those massing model, sketch images or photos, or from interior or exterior, and use those images as the base to have the exact results you want. So it's more controllable. For instance, here you can upload a sketch and a reference image. We will do one-shot learning right away. So you will see this is exactly what you want. very precise in terms of the lines or the volume, the geometry, but as well as the style is precisely from this style reference image. You can do anything with it, like the hand sketches or like a photo from somewhere and cramping paper. And you can, yeah, find some creation ideas. We have a lot of users using this function to get their really brilliant ideas from a fruit or whatever plants. Yeah, so it's very fun to work with AI in this way. And we can also allow people to editing on top of it. For instance, if you're not really satisfied with this facade, then you can just select it and say, okay, I want a wooden facade. Then it will turn into a wood facade in a smooth way. As well as if we want to change the shape, not into this this form or not really this geometry, then we can ask it for a more curvy shape. So then you can get a more smoothly, yeah, curvy shape. So this is how it works. And we have this training system. I will make it very short of this training system because it's very important. It's based on our big model and allow people to train their own model in a really simple way. So in this way, you can just upload your images, and these images just belong to you, of course, and nobody can see it. And you train your model, and you can store your model, and you can download your model. You can use it for whatever use you want. But if you want to share it with someone else, we can also encourage you to do so, because we can testing like different aspects for you, and you can like keep iterate your own model. So when you use it, you just find your model here, and then you can get your like own trained model with your office style or your personal style. And then we have this sharing system. So we have Inspiration Plaza and the Model Agora. One is for the generate the results to sharing, another is for the training model to sharing. I will switch a bit to my platform right now. You can see what it looks right now. Can you see this platform? Yeah, this is how LookX looks right now in this Creation Plaza. So all those works here you see are done by our users. For instance, we can take a look of this one. Yeah, it's like a high rise. And how they did it is they published this one to this sharing plaza, Creation Plaza, and this is their sketches and a reference image. So you can see exactly like how it works. So you can do the comparison of your sketch and the result, and we can also allow our user, also this is, I think this is from same user, and they can also allow to really enlarge the quality to improve the quality of it. So the sketch maybe is a little bit fuzzy, but here the result is really good. So there's a lot of results or a lot of things done by the users. You can take a look, and if you like it, you can like give it a like, or you can also store it for your further reference. So there's a lot of things you can play with it. Yeah, I will go back to my presentation. There's a lost a few pages then. Okay. So what we do also, we work with the softwares like the Rhino and SketchUp. Those are most popular softwares. And we have these plugins, though, so people can download these plugins, of course, in English version, and then you can just use it. So we compared us with the Midjourney and the Stable Diffusion. We find out our creation is very much into the architecture industry. And so we have those terms very precisely matching with what we want as architects, as well as we have softwares, we have very control systems, et cetera, to help architects to get what they want. And for the training part, it will be very easy. You don't have to buy your own GPU and set up its environment to do so. Just upload your image. You can, yeah, just get your model very easy and will really help everyone to get what they want. And the last thing is the future. What we're going to do is to really using chatbot to link our previous softwares with the LookX. So the creation is not just stopping in terms of the images itself, but also we can extend to 3D. So this is it. Yeah, thank you, Neil.
Thank you. Thank you, Wanyu. Things are happening so quickly. We've had a few technical challenges here. Michel Rojkind has powered out in his house. He's back with us now. We also have Refik has joined us, who is whose flight was delayed by 3.5 hours. So it's great to see the two of you. I don't know who's ready to go first. Maybe Michel, you want to go? Maybe you're more ready. I don't know.
I could try, Neil. Sorry, guys. Now I'm gonna. In a coffee shop, I needed to. There was like no power. It like 3 blocks. I had to walk to the next place where they had a connection. But let me try to share my screen. And first of all, honored of being here with all of you. Amazing presentations. I wanted to go back. Okay, I think it's this one. Let me see if you can see my presentation.
Yes.
Full screen. And let me know if it's advancing. There? Yes?
Yes, yes.
Okay, perfect. So, thanks, Neil, again. It's a pleasure to be amongst all of you. I admire all of your work and I'm super blown away by everything you're doing. I wanted to go in a much more simpler way, a little bit maybe back to basics, learning from very elemental things that are happening right now. I was talking to my daughter and some of her friends. My daughter's 18 years old, trying to explain a little bit of what was going on in the AI world in terms of designing images. So what I wanted to show her was a little bit like this, that the idea that I'm jumping back and forth softwares. I'm trying to ask ChatGPT to design prompts for us, which I'm embedding all the formulas that have happened with Midjourney over the years, asking ChatGPT if it understands what I'm giving it as a result. And it's been giving me very interesting feedback, but so the idea of not only working with Midjourney or DALL-E or Stable Diffusion, but what happens if ChatGPT is also involved with the development of the prompts in Midjourney and also the new technologies that are happening with AI in Photoshop, for instance, an image generated with the Midjourney when we were asking what the synergy or the symbiosis between buildings and nature and the interrelationship or a more intrinsic relationship. This is just the image that resulted from there. This is the image expanded in Photoshop, which is insane what the AI in Photoshop is interpreting, which taking from the very basic image that we have, and just by extending the image, it gives us an idea of what it could be. Again, a very simple image designed in Midjourney, but then extended also with Photoshop. And then, so this dialogue of ChatGPT designing the prompts, but then passing it or creating an image, but then having Photoshop extended without knowing the prompt or not knowing what is going on. And we tried it with very different images as well, not only some interiors that and you get to choose, once you extend the images, you have all these options that you can work with and keep on transforming the images, but it's learning really quickly on the images that it is seeing, the results of any type of image. And again, this is not things that we're doing at the office. This is just a way of understanding the softwares that we have right now and the relationship of not only image generated softwares, but in the case of ChatGPT, the text that you can ask for more information, and the more we're feeding information to ChatGPT, the more the results it's giving us back. So again, this is an extension of in Photoshop. I mean, even asking if we wanted like super old vintage photography of something under construction, that it could give us a result that could be also interesting. And again, extending it in Photoshop to understand. How is it reading it? What is it taking into consideration? How we can learn from that? and that by mixing and matching the different options. And then once we have this image that is extended with outside of the Midjourney, then we take it back to Midjourney. There's a prompt or a function to ask it to describe an image. And we ask it to describe an image, and we actually are figuring out how it understands the image that was then produced outside of Midjourney, back into Midjourney, and then prompting the results that it gives us or it's interpreting. So again, very, very basic, but trying to help some students and people also at the office that the ideas of how we can not only work with one software and get married to one software, but actually start working with softwares and the interrelationship of them and how we can push forward and have a more advanced outcome. And again, I mean, these are just some of the last images that we produced and high resolution that you can go as deep as you want into the image. Now it has like a 4x, which before you didn't have as much resolution. Now you're getting much more higher resolution. And again, in a way, understanding how we can mix and match and jump from platform to platform, either if it's text or if it's video or it's, or image based, how can we have the best results and how we can start creating a part that understands the language. So again, using ChatGPT to understand the formulas, but how can it give us some cultural ideas of how we can take it a step forward. And again, this is very simple geometry, it's not as the ones that we've seen right now, but I think it's interesting to also see on a very basic level things that could be produced. And this is what I had to present and to start the conversation also. So again, I mean, things that we're reviewing at the office, but very short presentation. Thanks for your patience and waiting for me to run to the coffee shop.
Michel, thank you. That was fascinating to see what's going on in the office. Refik, it's great to have you here. Refik, I'd say, has just been delayed. It's thrown everything out, but it's great to see you, Refik, as always. Are you able to share your screen?
Yes. So good morning from New York, everyone. Sorry, I was in Michigan yesterday with a very epic delays, and now in New York. By the way, for anyone in New York, our show at MoMA, the artwork is in permanent collection, but the piece will be closing end of next week. So last moment, but it will be traveling. So hopefully you can see around the world. So let me quickly share my screen.
I'm going to be in New York next week, Refik, so I look forward to seeing it.
Amazing. Wonderful. So it's so good to be here with everyone. I mean, Patrik, and I mean, first of all, Neil, always bringing us together in this beautiful event with wonderful minds, deeply appreciated. So I want to quickly share about our process as a studio using machine hallucinations. The project kind of started almost 2016. 2016 February, there was an event in February in Gray Area, and Google Friends were hosting the very first auction of like generative AI output to help and support underprivileged artists. And I was there to support the event and speak, but I didn't expect that. That day was also the moment that will turn into an amazing journey with AI. And this is Mike Taika, one of our liaison, and Kenneth McDowell and Bole Agora Arcas. Like, they have been like truly the first pioneers for us to like give us the light and torch to learn how to use AI and create an exciting journey. So for me, inspiration came from rather than just the technology, but mostly intellectually from this inspiring book, sort of story from Borges, Diary of Babel. And from that, we were able to create, I think, the very first installation using a real-time bot, image findings and image embeddings, and also like try to create this three-dimensional audiovisual library where there is no search bar, there is no book, there is no shelf. And in this library, we start to understand the 1.7 million documents by looking at the entire data archive. And the other question was, when the archive is idle, the speculation was, what happens if it can dream? Because if machine can learn, can a library and archive dream and hallucinate? I mean, again, 7 years ago, these are now ancient looking GAN models. But for me, that was like a really, really, really inspiring, you know, time and experiments. And of course, if one day machine can dream or data can become a pigment, I thought that it doesn't need to dry. It can constantly shift, shape, it can constantly take data as a material and transform it. Over the years, we look for many different forms of like latent space, try to understand how we can narrate in latent space, how we can understand this universe. And last 7 years, we download more than 4 billion images and construct many, many different AI models and train, I think, more than 400 models in different topics, specifically focusing nature, space, urban, and culture. And over the years, that was, I think, this type of algorithms and softwares, as you see, we were able to create kind of a more purposeful latent space explorations and make the tool making was very important in the studio. This is, for example, one of our real-time applications that real-time allows me to fly in 100,000 samples of a GAN model that is heavily modified and have it like a real-time, another an iPad application touch. So I see that I can quickly reconstruct certain parameters of the latent space. And of course, this transformed into this series of paintings and sculptures and performances. And over the last 7 years, explore different aesthetics, but still try to find the meaning of like fluid dynamics as much as I'm super obsessed now, 11 years, I guess, since I started like working with fluid dynamics. And also, of course, thanks to Casey Rias at UCLA 2012, I also started programming with, you know, processing and exercise of the image and beyond. But I think what really transformed my imagination is truly the idea of like iterative like design and processes like through these algorithms. We also have a deep focus on lower dimension reductions. We have been doing lots of analysis of like how information can be transformed through the machine findings and how we can transform what AI can see, hear, and read, and how we can reconstruct those realities in the form of sculptures, paintings, and so on. And of course, as Carl Sagan said, this was just the beginning part of it. As an artist, deeply, deeply inspired and respect the architecture, and always deeply inspired from the form finding of architecture materials, I thought that perhaps it's a good time to speculate the idea of embedding AI into architecture. And last 7 years, we really tried to create many different forms of immersive environments, transform historic spaces. While transforming historic spaces, we look even the data that ever like played in that. This was, by the way, a former theater, cinema theater for 110 years. And we were able to take the theaters like previous information, transform all the scripts of the movies, and then, you know, project it back to itself. This type of like, you know, information, using the information from the memory of a building and giving it back to it through AI became an exciting fun. But of course, 2014, while I graduated from the UCLA, my thesis project was Frank Gehry's Disney Hall, the idea of if this building can dream and hallucinate the history of LA Philharmonic, the home of LA Philharmonic. And we were able to do it actually 2018, which was a really important piece for us because it was a very much a major undertaking, 42 projectors, each 4K, and transform 100 years of every single information that we can find from LA Philharmonic. And this was, I believe, one of the first example of using truly large scale AI embedded audiovisual performance. And on top of it, we got significantly major recognition in the city that transformed our relationship with also Bay Area and beyond. It was a really, really exciting and challenging project for us. And also this project brought 100,000 people together in 5 nights in Los Angeles. As far as I know, it was the largest public art installation ever triggered the public in Los Angeles. And of course, we had other experiments in the other forms of embedding AI into architecture, which was 2019, 1 year later, in Chelsea Market in Arctic House. This time, we had 130 million images of New York, which the idea this time was, instead of one just two-dimensional world, can we step inside this experience? Can we step inside and three-dimensionally before XR, VR, or AR still embrace the physical quality of life and the architecture? And this project also received a significant audience, and it was, I believe, one of the first experiment on 18 channels video, each 4K, 32 channel sound. We completely help Artacast like create, design all the infrastructures and so on. Learn so much here, and about like how truly transform an existing void space to transform it into a canvas. And I think and that was like a very much big trigger point for many experiential art. And I see many, many examples have been done in different ways. Of course, our wonderful collaboration in generative AI, which was way before DALL-E or Midjourney or Stability AI, any of those were like even the public. With Patrik and Zahad, architect friends, we were able to like create very much early, maybe the first version of like plotting an image from these neural networks and 3D designing the space through that image, and then transform this information into a three-dimensional experience where we can go and see and feel the output from neural network. As far as I know, this was a profoundly very first days of generative AI, way before anything going on right now. So I guess this 2 years, 2.5 years is so fast that things change extremely quick. But grateful for Patrik and everyone that was, we were able to generate this extraordinary immersive environment with a DDP in Seoul, and hope it travels around the world. And if you can see, as far as I know, these are the very first generative output from those neural networks that have been 3D transformed and became an experience in life. And then, lastly, last year, we had a chance to transform Gaudi's Casabatio. This time, we took the facade data from the UNESCO Heritage Information, which is a 1.2 billion LiDAR scanning of the facade, and pair with a weather station. And then we were able to create this real-time game engine application where we can real-time transform the facade and the weather behaviors. But the big difference was not just only put the facade in just, you know, this virtual environment. We transform the real physical world facade into a canvas. It was a remarkable experience with major activation. It was only for one night, but we received right now, I mean, I didn't expect it, to be honest, this level of like love from the city, but I do believe that using his heritage and archive and information and reconstructing the facade and details and all his material imaginations, we were able to bring 65,000 people together. As far as I know, one of the largest audience ever came together for public art. And I think they come to like hug the building. They love Gaudian so much, and that was an incredible moment. And lastly, I guess today, I'm so happy to share that our journey right now is in Las Vegas in this incredibly inspiring building called the Sphere. As many of you know, that this is a pretty much equirectangular ultra, like a 550 feet wide, 326 feet high, just incredible surface. The project right now is also at the U2 inside, and then Dred Arnowski's Postcard from Earth piece. I'm deeply, deeply honored with such an incredible artist, and I'm deeply honored that they choose our studio to like really deep dive in this madness. I'm saying madness because we start much, much earlier, and early days of like understanding technology, early days of understanding like mapping techniques. And it was something very, very challenging, but it was exciting. So at the moment we are transforming the data from the Winds of Vegas, our wind data painting series, as you can see in real time. And we have ISS data for the Earth, like to see our planet from the space, and they're like paintings and data sculpture series. We have Hubble telescope studies and more coming back to back to back. But it's a truly architectural marvel, engineering marvel. I truly believe that it works to go there and see it by physical eyes and be in the space. It has profound experience on both music and sound design, and definitely on the peripheral vision. And I believe they change the performing arts. And it will be a very exciting next decade. Probably it will trigger many other things. So thank you very much for listening.
Wow, Refik, that was stunning. I want to go and see that thing in Las Vegas. I saw some of the interiors as well from that YouTube event. It was at YouTube, amazing, amazing. And what we're seeing is history in the making. We are seeing history in the making. I just wanted to make one comment.
Daniel.
I don't know if Patrik, you want to go and show your final presentation.
Yeah, well, look, fantastic stuff, man! Wow, and we kind of got absorbed into this whole AI thing, and I was showing some snippets earlier about what our research team is doing, and thanks to Refik actually, and also Neil's thing, and also watching what Daniel was doing, we are onto it. We're kind of novices and latecomers, but we're now full on. And I mean, it was just, I was blown away by Wanyu's presentation, by the way, where this is the next level, where with this kind of training up of an AIs, and you have a whole kind of package the tools you're developing, you're giving them out there and have developed them with smooth interfaces. So I would love to see, you know, have a kind of offline communication with some of you and the research team who are in the weeds, and I kind of only can show you glimpses of it. But you know, it's amazing, you can upload your images. I mean, we're doing at the moment, I wanted to ask Wanyu about tagging, but let me show you just simply another little snippet of what we're doing or trying to do. And the question of kind of tagging these, which is another kind of interesting task, but is that, yeah, okay, wait. Are we having this one here? Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
So this kind of trying to do a kind of tag library and working with different categories to classify our projects. Of course, we have a huge image base which has classifications as well, but we're going back and looking at interiors, but also urban. Actually, I mixed up some of these images, urban conditions. And then we are using this kind of control net to put in the site and iterate through variations on the urban scale. So it's a new level of parametric urbanism. And then having some of these nets with degrees or calibrated with amounts of being kind of taking over the fabric with coming in with different weights. And so I think this is, I guess, interfaces with some of the things you've been trying to do, and I really what I'm calling for is learning more how we can optimize our processes and get your advice and feedback on whether we're on the right track, because you've been in this for years and we're in this for kind of maybe weeks and few months. So I think that would be a plea. We would dissimulate doing with interiors and going in with tagging tectonic features, spatial features, and so on, and trying to grapple with this, and then combining that with the larger model. Anyway, I just wanted to show these glimpses, and we gotta have an offline meeting because I'm just sitting here learning, and my eyes are wide open, and my ears are trying to grasp on techniques. So that we collectively, for the discipline, tailor these models. And I think what just one you just showed is kind of, and Daniel in particular, and also what Michael was just showing, is very important that we're remaining on the forefront of this. And and Photoshop is great, what you've been showing, we can use it, but what can we bring to the table as a discipline? And I look to you guys to help us making the next step.
And no problem, Patrik. It's our pleasure to work with you guys. Yeah, we really are looking to this system for years, and yes, there's a lot of things to do. And I think we can help you to build your own.
That would be great.
Fantastic platform internally. Yeah.
Or at least to maintain, to be updated, because I think we're coming from a different generation.
Staying updated.
It always takes more time, but I think it's important what you're saying, Patrik, the way we feedback into any platform. But yes, please, let's do something that we can all learn more together.
Yeah,
I'm kind of struck just because Refik mentioned Blaze. We have Blaze tomorrow, by the way, coming on. And just thinking about this in terms of time, right? 2016, he had this TED talk, how AI is learning to be creative, how computers are learning. Amazing. You know, and 2019 was a moment when we teamed up with Blaze, with Google, with Refik, with Zahedid Architects to go and propose something, the Venice Biennale. We weren't even shortlisted. 2019 was when Refik what we were planning to do, which is say hallucinate buildings, took the Zahedid archive, produced that first ever GAN image. And then just last year, we're talking May of 2022, the first ever diffusion model, again by Refik, again collaborating with the work of Zahedid Architects, that came out. We are in a kind of fast forward moment that's happening right now. And I think actually where we're at the moment, and this is a comment from Ben Bratton, we are just in the silent movies period. In other words, we're amazed by what's happening. Next year, we're just going to be, that was just 2023. These things, it's really happening fast forward. It's quite astonishing. And we absolutely need to have these sessions online, bringing the world together, literally, to be updated on these things. So it was just astonishing, amazing. I wanted to just throw out one sort of comment, and that is to say, well, you know, maybe in the future, we won't even be talking about AI. It'll be so much embedded in what we do. I'm thinking back when I was a student, you'd have these drawings, right? And then CAD drawings were coming along when I was a student. And you say, oh, CAD drawing, but a drawing was what you did by hand. Now we're in a situation whereby everything is computational. And if it's a hand drawing, you say a hand drawing. That is that, you know. So we will probably be in a situation where we're just talking about design or architecture or art or whatever. And AI will just be assumed as being part of the logic of how we operate. But it is
absolutely the way Photoshop integrates it, and I mean, we're working on a Maya plugin actually, and Wanyu has already the Rhino Grasshopper plugins. I mean, that's the way it becomes naturalized, and you don't think about it anymore. It's not even a special site you have to go to. It's integrated in the workflow, and that's the way it should be. And it's really empowering all of us.
Sorry, Neil, you just said something so inspiring, because the art world, I don't know the architecture world, but art world is so slow. It's so slow that people are just realizing the world is changing. I mean, I'm so happy that architectural culture and the space and design culture is so open-minded, so embracing like the world. I mean, I'm just so happy to be here as an artist, but I'm really very like so happy to see that like as this tool making integration, like it just becomes natural world, that while art world is like thinking forever, like it's before, it's just, I don't know, there's a big time difference. Big.
No, but I say the opposite. I say the architects need to wake up, because I think that you are there October 2022 in LA to see that projection, which was really, I know you'd done that projection before, but that scale of operation, that to my mind, symbolically was when AI met architecture, but you'd been working on it before. So we were always behind in some senses. I mean, Blaze's first exhibition, I think it was 2016 of Deep Dream generated art. So architects have been playing catch up, but I do think that we are actually using our creative imagination to play around with these things. It's not just the tool, but what you do. So the creativity is coming with the tool, but it's the creative use of it, which is truly, truly astonishing. And I think some of the work we saw, for example, Arturo and Chantal's use of animation and amazing stuff, very beautiful stuff. Maybe Daniel, I just like to, because you're always sort of quietly working in the background and doing some astonishing sort of work, but very modest about it. I want to just kind of try to get you to say just something about what you've seen today and how you see things going forward.
Yeah, I think it's promising. Yeah, like what I've seen today, I think we are moving in the right direction. Like I'm always afraid of this kind of attitude where there is doom and people think that AI is going to replace us. And it's very refreshing to see today that people actually, they see that there is something, we can do some amazing things with AI. And it's great to see this kind of openness, yeah. It's great to see that now, just because AI is going to help us here, we can become even more creative in OEM. You always have fears with technology. Like even back in the days when you had the printing press, you had a fear that there's going to be a lot of misinformation and a lot of heresy. Yeah? And then later when we had even internet, it was the same thing. With the internet, it was the fear that there's a lot of disinformation. We ended up with a lot of democratizing of information. Before, when we had paper and the writing, I think it was, who was it? I'm blanking on the name, but there was the fear that writing and the paper is going to actually replace our memory. We are not going to be able to remember anymore. Yeah. And on the contrary, we started to explore, we started to be able to share the knowledge and so on. Yeah. So I think with AI and again, today's session, like for me, I feel very positive. I see that we are going to become more creative. We are going to find new ways of how to engage with AI, with architecture. I think we are going to start to open discussions that were not accessible prior to this to us. just because we had no access to those kind of topics. Like, for example, if you talk about semantics, I think Patrik, like, I know that Patrik, you had this kind of parametric semiology and all that, and I was part of that discourse. So how do you build, in a way, a sort of architecture language? But even that one, it's a bit like limiting in the sense of it's up to your ability as a human to be able to comprehend it. But with AI, I think you can put that on steroids. Yeah, you can explore that idea, you know, and really understand semantics and understand language and develop language and all that. Yeah. So personally, I'm very, very positive. Yeah. After this session.
Can I ask something really quick, Neil? I'm just very curious. And again, as Patrik was mentioning, I mean, having all you guys being on the forefront of everything going on, Arturo, I mean, if I'm thinking about public policies and how at some point AI can start influencing how we're creating cities, not only the buildings that we're doing or designing, but how we see the future of this being embedded in political decisions of how to build cities and how to expand cities. I mean, I would love to hear your opinion because that's where I'm most curious about, because I keep seeing isolated, amazing examples of beautiful buildings that are amazing, but they're rarely connected to either infrastructure or parks or cities or communities. Or so is there a way that at some point we can start incorporating leaders to understand the importance of embedding AI in their political decisions? Just as an open question. And by the way, Refik, I just came back from Vegas to see the Sphere, Aronofsky's film. Mind-blowing totally. So yes.
I mean,
actually, I want to answer Michelle's question. Yeah, because we had a really experiencing this because we worked with some big clients. One of it called Hong Kong New World. It's a commercial mall developer. They have more than 20 shopping malls in Hong Kong and China, Greater China areas. And what we work with them is we help them to understand what is the design could be in the future. So we do the simulation by the artificial intelligence agencies to simulate what's gonna happen in the future of this building. And those artificial intelligence are not creating from nowhere, but from the big data. Those big data are like, is not sensitive at all, but those information will be connecting by those map providers. They will understand how many percentage of females in this area and male in this area, what is their favorite shopping timing, or what is the brand, etc. So we got those information, we can create those intelligence agencies with the characters from the big data. And then we can create like thousands of those agencies and put them into the design. So those agencies will like travel around and do some behaviors to interact with this space. And with those kind of data, like they can like do it 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, and then we can see what's gonna be in the future. And this kind of data will help the decision makers to understand it's not just the looks beautiful, but it works. For instance, what's the distance from the each level's escalator towards the shops? What's the average distance? And is the escalator sufficient in peak hours, or the toilet sufficient? All those things can be simulated and be evaluated before the construction starts. So this is something, yeah, we are really practicing, and it really helps. And so the client eventually put us into their kind of a company policy that all their new designs or new shopping malls need to be reviewed by us, by AI. So this is something, it's already happening. Yeah.
I mean, you raised a question about construction. And so maybe, Michelle, do you want to make a point first, or we can, sorry. No, okay. No, I just wanted to say that the kind of, obviously what architects do is design and representation. We don't necessarily build things as such. But the question ultimately, I think, is I'm doing something with Turner Construction this week in New York, and they will want to know, how does it impact on construction itself? And I know that Wanyu's work is looking at from data to fabrication. But I think the question about construction and where AI will really play a role in that is a little bit, it's not so clear yet. Any thoughts on that?
I think so, but I also want to hear from some people today.
You go ahead, first of all.
Yeah, okay. Our point is that we're using DFMA with AI. DFMA is a kind of industrialized design principle, designed for manufacturing and assembly. So it's not a design for ideas, inspirations, but we are combining the idea inspirations as well as with the DFMA. So it's not done by human brain, to be honest. This needs to be assisted by the AI, because the AI can help to compose all the components together. For instance, you can treat all those prefabs, like the MIC components, as the Lego pieces, and the AI can try to compose into something workable with your ideas or your design. So this is something, it's already, we're trying. It's not everywhere is already mature, but I think this is the right direction.
And just briefly, Michael's questions with respect to how these tools help us to interface in the political process as a process of persuasion, participation, and we are not working with public audience at this level, but with client audiences. And what is clear that you can have lay audiences much quicker responding to options and proliferate further options, and they're all rendered in a way that they can grasp it, that it has this detail and depth and rendering quality to participate in early ideation. And that's already showing that this comes on quicker. And oftentimes we have competitions where we have interim presentations with clients where we wouldn't have the renderings yet. But we have, they wouldn't respond to kind of screenshots and so on. And now there's, so the quality of participation, but also of course the number of options one can kind of appraise and value. And then in homing in with these new tools, is iterating something in front of them, say, stop, what's go back, running the parameterized model up back and forth. So that's also, let's say it's a kind of process of allowing more people, it's another form of democratization into the participation process. The other thing which I wanted to respond to what Wanyu was just saying in terms of the AI, which isn't necessarily image-based or in terms of the creative process, but also folded in into an analytic evaluative process, right? So when we're doing these agent-based models and we're using, gaming AI to have occupancy simulations with intricately differentiated agents models, but also I currently work in a PhD and works quite well with one of my team members at Tongji, actually, and you know it, Neil, that we're developing using AI systems to semantic tagging, they're learning to recognize features of complex scenes and to simulate the kind of, and then also there's this loop of calibrating that with test audiences, and both with terms of this task of recognition, so and you seeing what the legibility or recognizability is of certain features in a complex space, do they recognize the escalators, as well as navigability, using AI systems to kind of simulate navigability, of course, and also, let's say, generative forms of machine learned tools which produce solutions, not images, but geometry solutions, right? So we're filling, and that is very important if you have a floor plate of 25,000 square meter, like in some of our buildings, and you want to fill that with meeting rooms or with also smaller areas with desks, and you generate, you can have multiple parameters to generatively fill this space with functional geometries, and then dial, then calibrate permeability, dense packing, diversity, of the how many of the modules, it is modular based, how much mixity and diversity is within the model, and then homing in on functionality criteria. So that's another form of AI, which I think obviously was there before this huge explosion of image AI, And I would include things like structural, you know, topology optimization, structural form finding, and so on. These are all generative important, and we need to integrate them. I mean, and we need to not forget them. And this is a part of that huge kind of capacity, the explosion nearly of our field, which I'm excited about. And particular, one more thing, when I've been developing, and by the way, my book on tectonism is out. And the first lecture about tectonism was given in, on the invitation of Neil and Tong Ji. And there, for instance, there's certain limitations still in the AI system that if you wanted to have this kind of level of rigor in terms of structurally optimized solutions or structurally coherent solutions, the AI systems fail at this point, because that's not, and so that's another frontier. So we can do beautiful parametricism, but we can't do tectonism with that level of rigor and of course directly out of these systems. So that's another challenge, another frontier. I want to say that the image is a fantastic in between, but it's not the end game.
This is what I've been arguing also with Deepin and Blau. Like when I'm talking about multi-node and this kind of node-based systems, that's what we are talking about. Like you have one node describing perhaps like structural optimization, the other one describing like more aesthetical aspects. Yeah. And the question is, how are these related to each other? Yeah. And right now, a challenge that we have, by the way, before I get there, there was Neil had a discussion with John Fraser, and he was making this critique about like Midjourney, where people are just using Zaha as a prompt in the prompt, and then you get an image of Zaha. And he was saying that that's not a Zaha building, because the Zaha building has also like the circulation flow, how it's optimized, and this and that. So there are so many layers to that to make that a Zaha building. Yeah. And I think also if you generalize now, also for something to become a building, there are so many other systems that have to be accounted for. Yeah. And right now we have a challenge with that, to be honest. Also in Coupé en Blau, and probably also in the case of Zaha, you have all the data. Yeah. You have all your projects, past projects. But even like that, there is a lot of data that is not accounted for. There is a lot of like information that we are not able to capture. Yeah, we are not able to capture really how the structure performs. Yeah, and even if we talk about digital twins, even there, like we cannot yet collect the entire data of a building, for example. Yeah, maybe in the future, once we have everything connected to sensors, maybe then we are going to be able to collect a lot of data about buildings, and then we are going to be able to, in a way, have AI models that really like learn all these kind of layers, all these kind of systems that typically we have in architecture.
But maybe I can just pick up on that, Daniel, because I was struck by your comment about Patrick's parametric semiology project of the past and how that locks into the kind of feature detection, shall we say, of AI. One thing struck me today, especially with Arturo and Chantal's amazing animated videos, was actually that logic could be seen this goes back to Snow's work for a PhD in terms of detecting features. You could animate that whole process. So you'd be talking about walking through a building. In other words, it's not just an image, it's a kind of a sequence that you're locked into. And I could see that as being the next step that really could open up AI as being part of. So you're overcoming John Fraser's critique, because it is part of the movement sequence as you go through a building. Arturo, do you want to go ahead?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I have a couple of open questions. One is for Daniel. Patrick mentioned FEM analysis, so one step before construction, which is structural behavior and analysis. There is an example. 1 year ago, when I started using Midjourney Stable Diffusion, I was creating a chair, a kind of lattice chair, and I realized that the image was kind of consistent in terms of structural behavior. So I had, for example, a small session on the ground and it was increasing. So I said, well, there is not an FEM analysis inside, but it was just mimicking, you know, chairs, lattice chairs that work, you know? So the question is, can we, for example, leverage, again, it's an open question, is it possible to leverage, let's say, open data for optimizing maybe seismic behavior in buildings and creating well-designed buildings through mimicking again? We were incorporating using algorithms, you know, the natural behavioral copy, inspired by Fry Otto or Sergio Musmeci using algorithms, you know. When I say algorithm, I mean if, then, zero, one. Is it possible, again, Daniel, maybe you have the answer. Is it possible to incorporate structural data and stresses and all the, you know, the techniques in a kind of new way, creating probably a novel engineering, which is not about using equation, but leveraging big data and combining things all together?
So, that idea of like through images, I know I had some experiments also, like trying to see if Midjourney understands materiality. And sometimes I use that as a sort of way of pushing myself out of preconceived ways of thinking about like how material should behave or something. And I think in that regard, and if we keep it at that conceptual level of design, I think that's an amazing way of exploring in a way and pushing the boundaries. If we go towards a more pragmatic, in a way, aspect, I think it's possible to have AI models for FMA like analysis, and but I think it's always like a question of we have a lot of data, but that data is very sparse. Yeah, in architecture, even there, like we don't have that much data, but even the data that we have is very sparse in a way. So it's hard in a way for us to really understand that and how the structures work. And it's mostly we are just making inference in a way on how the system behaves, but it's not necessarily that we understand the cause and effect, why certain things are happening. Yeah, we can use AI models for sure, just by examples. We don't have to input equations and stuff. We can use AI models just through examples to learn in a way how to give us some optimum structures, but it's hard to really evaluate them if they're really performing well or not. Yeah, because we don't know other factors that are within that structure, yeah? Other more granular data that we should have access to and we don't have access to right now. Yeah,
I mean, even on the kind of basic system logic, I haven't tried it recently. I was trying and playing around with DALL-E 2 a year ago or so, I realized that they don't get the structural systems right. Key members are missing things out of things. So that seems to be more free and open and complex. While, of course, the breakthrough was that it gets perspective right and light and shadow and some kind of plausibility and coherency of a geometry. The next step should be possible if you had the good data set. And you can constrain somehow the problem, that you will get good, structurally good solutions. And that's what I'm thinking about, you know, and let's say if we build up a kind of tectonism library and we can do that with structural articulated structures, visible structures. We can do that also with sun exposure, with kind of Brissolet transformations, etc. So it's possible, but it's not at the moment. We don't have that these samples and these samples tagged in ways that make sense. So for a chair, I accept, yes, this is probably comes with the territory and is a highly constrained type, but it doesn't extrapolate to bridges. Complex, you know, more complex bridge scenarios, which I've tried, and there's it's a bit of a shortfall, unfortunately, at the moment. But
and one big challenge here. Sorry, just to add to that, it's also like the aspect of with object design, it's quite easy, perhaps, to have to collect data about object design. Yeah, you have 3D models and so on. Yeah. I think with buildings is quite complex, and it's complex first because as a discipline, we are not very prone to share things with others. But then it's also like very pragmatic in a way, reasons why we don't have building shared with others, which have to do with clients or other kind of confidentiality kind of issues. Yeah. So suddenly then it's for us as a profession, it's very hard to put together a data set that really it's massive enough to say that you are able to learn something from it. Yeah. We always have this kind of very sparse in a way models here and there, a few. And even those, they lack so much detail when it comes to the details that you need in architecture.
No, I just kind of pick up on that, because I think the key question is the scale of operations. I'm fascinated right now by all these large language models. It's kind of like, actually, they're massive. They're not just large. But what's interesting is they start developing this understanding that, you know, something like GPT can learn languages. It can learn to code and so on. And we saw this earlier on, actually, with AlphaGo Zero, when it was able to learn the rules of Go without being taught it. And it's those kind of possibilities, I think, that are really intriguing. As soon as you've got enough data, it should be able to understand any system. And that's mind-blowing. That's mind-blowing.
And I think that's also a challenge when it comes to, right now, this is the paradigm when it comes to having machines learning, you know, yeah? Like you drop a ton of data and then the machine is learning, yeah? But sometimes in some task, I think that's a flawed, in a way, assumption that's how we get to intelligence, in a way. Yeah? And it might be that for architecture, what has to change is we have to change the kind of models that we're using in order to be able to deal with sparse data and still be able to extract intelligence from there, or intelligent design, let's say. Yeah? Because we cannot just rely right now, of course, for example, GAN models, they are not capable to have the same amount of data like a diffusion model has, yeah? But a diffusion model with the amount of data that a GAN has is not going to perform well, yeah? So depending on the architecture of the model, one works better with a smaller data set, the other one with a massive data set, yeah? So I think in architecture, probably that's how we solve the problem. We start to look at which are the architecture of this kind of network that we are dealing with. Do we have to develop our own networks in a way to deal with this kind of sparse data and more limited amount of data?
I mean, I definitely predict that when you can use AI as an accelerator, if you have a simulation, for instance, let's say topology optimization, where you put in the loads, the support points, and you have thousands of these running through, that the AI would reproduce those, and you then just input this. Similarly, we've done actually something similar within the research program, if you remember, with Matthias, where we run these kind of cumbersome and long winding agent simulations, and you have heat maps, which we then kind of feed into a system and predict the heat map based on the plan. So I think this probably might exist already or could be done for each specific kind of task as an accelerator of an otherwise cumbersome simulation. I don't know if it would work with fluid dynamics, but it probably could.
It will for sure. That's how I started with AI, to be honest. I was very much involved with agent-based systems, and I was trying to bring structural performance into agent-based systems. So one way to do that is write code for GPU, CUDA programming. But that's very expensive, you know, it takes a lot of time. So I started looking into predictions. I started to have AI models that are predicting, in a way, the layout for the topology optimization. And then you connect that to an agent-based system. So the optimization now runs in the background real time, and you have the agent system being informed now, yeah? So those are possible, in a way. But I think also for us as architects, like, I don't know why we have the obsession with extremely big models. Like, you can do fascinating things as a creative with small models, you know, like it's just up to you how creative you want to be and how you want to use certain models and for what kind of task. I think it's just, you have to split in a way the design problem in multiple tasks perhaps, yeah? And then see in a way which are the possibilities, which are the opportunities for smaller models in a way, yeah?
Just taking it a step forward, Daniel, and what Patrick was saying and going back to you, Arturo. I'm concerned about, yes, I mean, Mexico is a seismic zone, so there's earthquakes here. And we're always concerned about what we need from nature in order to for a building to be coherent to the site that it's being designed and built in. What happens in the future when the building becomes a thermometer of Earth? If my building can give me metrics of how the Earth is behaving, not only seismic, but how is the soil underneath the building? So we're being filled as humans with all these gadgets, the Aura rings, the Apple watches, like everything giving me my metrics of how my body is. Do we see a future, at least I see a future, where buildings can become these thermometers for Earth in a more intrinsic relationship, no? Does the building, is the soil beneath the building needing more humidity right now? So can the building provide water in that instance to the Earth below us for the soil to, I think this is a very interesting process where the future of architecture cannot just be, yes, we're collecting some power with solar cells, or we're harnessing the wind, or collecting rainwater. I think this is the group that I think could be more in tune with that, no?
Maybe I could just suggest, I think what is interesting to my mind is when it can interpolate information from visual material, right? So you can either take the St. Gaudi approach, right? And you can do the hanging chain model, which of course is a beautiful study. It reminded me of Refik's work today, but or you can, what's interesting is Midjourney can do those drapes. It understands that is how material will drape. So as long as there's visual evidence of it, it can interpolate from that. But I think the seismic thing about the risk of something happening where you haven't got visual evidence so far might be more tricky. But maybe I have to bring in Refik here, because you've been listening patiently to all us architects talking.
Yeah. Yeah, I just really just love this conversation so much, because I think what Daniel mentioned 100% so right on. I think the idea of using, so at the moment, I think generative AI models, GANs can be so powerful if the data is large enough, while diffusion models are so humble, right? But I think what I am trying, since I think, it's a very humble experiment, nothing major. It was just a fun study, started end of February. So we tried look at these models, what happens if each other feeds each other. So just want to quickly show this, because again, it's not, just fun, not nothing yet. So our ultimate goal was really try, we have this a major nature love, and we have 75 million flower images. And I was just looking at these images and they were exciting. And when they become something was exciting, but then we turn them, the imagination in reality was limited. And then we fed 75,000 diffusion models outputs from this archive. And it was really interesting thinking, because then you have these two sides of the world. One is just completely different architecture. One is completely different architecture. So I'm calling them diffusion GANs. I don't know whatever people are calling it. But so in February, it was just exciting. And then this summer, beginning of summer, we did a project with Dior to visualize the perfume, the formula of the perfume. And then it was before, by the way, Animate Diff, we were able to even give at this moment to diffusion models. And I think what I'm understanding is there's this really, really inspiring space where, again, it's not maybe as Patrik predicted, that gives super accurate, maybe engineering ready world, but there is one world when these two worlds connect. And I don't know if we can see more than what we see so far, but I do believe mixing matching models as quick as possible will give a new world. I just feel it, but I can't prove it. I don't know.
I love that, Refik. I love that this kind of idea of we have to move beyond this kind of discussion only about data set, because you have two models.
Yeah.
Those are complete two universes. You have full access to those. What do you do with them? Yeah. So you can, there's so exactly. Much untapped in a way, potential there. It's fascinating that you guys started to look into combining those things. Yeah.
Just for fun, again.
Terrific. Do you have a video of that project? What came out? Because it was just so stunning that I
thank you. It opened in Paris. It's very interesting. We always think about the materials, but I think scent as a material is so powerful, right? Or other type of sensorial information. By the way, at this fair, if you go, you will see that they couldn't achieve perfect, to be honest, but the idea was really bring atmospheric effects to a level, not Disney, not Universal, but really a place that you can animate, use them as a material in your storytelling, such as atmospheric effects of the fog and they couldn't achieve the scent realistically because there's 18,000 seats, but the idea was there. So we took that similar world and It's Savita Bulgari, but it was really fun. It was really fun. It's just like a media space. It's just a perfect LED media wall, 0.9 millimeter. It is just extraordinary quality space. And then we transformed the formula, an original formula, into fluid dynamics. But in between stage, that's we have different like simulations inside the room that, you know, total amount of molecules transforms into like numbers. And then those numbers transforms into these like creatures that are constantly like, you know, these are all the flowers that the master parfumery used in his formula. So we take the perfume into it, I guess, space that you can go inside. But it was really experimental. But I believe if we bring the architecture in the game, which is much more complex, most likely from different perspectives, there's a future here, I think, that can generate new universes. And one more thing, I'm really inspired, of course, this conversational AI, right? Now, I believe we are going to this experiential AI, which is more interesting to me than just having conversations, because conversations are just intellect in the mind and in the dialogues. But experiential AI is where we experience it beyond just like text and in our minds. I believe the next decade, at least artistically thinking, to really feel these models, like touch them, taste them, you know, feel them. And I think that's hopefully will make bring more fun.
Yeah, I would like to see something as well. Because I also think AI is not just diffusion model and GANs model today. Actually, there's a lot of algorithm models, big models, and those models can do different things. For instance, we used to use machine learning, also traditional way, but with the GANs plus clustering, we can also do a lot of fun things. For instance, how to find out the best option for the facade from like more than 30,000 different tiles into 12 pieces. I mean, 12 standard tiles. So this kind of things are like, we also need to do a lot of experiments, like how to use different model in different scenarios or different aspects to see what we can do. And then we can spread this idea to others and to see how those algorithms can help us to improve the design. Yeah, this is something, I mean, everyone here is really pushing the boundary. I really admire everyone's work.
You know what, responding also to Refik's comment about, you know, feeling and entering these models, I mean, where I see, let's say, on the more creative and explorative side of things, the route into architecture is probably through the metaverse.
Yes.
And that will also be the more the kinetic systems. And this could still in the end feed into architecture because there will remain a strong interlinkage, because a lot of organizations will have both, you know, metaverse virtual spaces, real spaces, there will be digital twin space extensions, and exploring some of these more creative end of the spectrum in the metaverse. And some of them will not obviously be able to be brought back, but will be functional. You know, let's say the challenge to you as an architect, and similarly to people like Jason Bruce, who're doing a lot of interactive installations, is to bring it back into a social functionality where these spaces become productive for interaction, communication, display, collaboration. And I mean, it's 2 days ago, our Metatropy metaverse, by the way, is really taking off nicely. And we just had a beautiful launch of 3 new piano designs with Rosie Chance, beautiful music, visuals, conversations around it. And I mean, we have to come back to you, Refik. You need to come in and
please.
You know, create something in this metaverse, and we also shifted in, maybe those who have registered can keep going back at demand, and we're accumulating a community who keeps going back and going back in. So, and anyway, this goes to all of you here, so that we should have it. You know, I will let you know more about it. In particular, you, Refik, we should install things in our metaverse, and that's, you know.
We'll be there immediately.
I think the interface between Refik's world and our world, I mean, Refik's already been kind of very architectural in any way, but I think it's breaking down. I can see it breaking down, and we're going to get into a more seamless interaction between these different spheres of operation.
It will be a dream to connect more.
I would have asked Michel, because Michel is somebody who, I mean, I'm astonished by his productivity anyway and the ideas and things. But Ref, what's interesting about him is he has a background in music. Now, I want to know when that is going to reignite and how AI might bring that back into the vision.
Well, I mean, I've been, thanks, Neil, for bringing that up. Yeah, I used to be a drummer my friends that don't know a little bit of my past, I used to play professionally, but and left music for a long time. I mean, I've been in architecture full on and I haven't had too much time to go back to music, but I'm thinking of what happens if I start doing like sound installations based on very primitive drumming, but with new technology that could advance the way we're feeling spaces. So nothing clear yet, Neil, but things will happen soon. I mean, again, I was blown away, Refik, with Aronofsky's film, Postcards from Earth. Not only was, I mean, inside the sphere, the imagery of Aaron, who I love as a filmmaker, but also the wind that, I don't know where it comes from in the sphere, but you're getting the wind of the images and you're getting the smell of the orange fields. And it's like, it's almost there, no? Without having a headset on, but the experience is just becoming this beautiful, seamless thing. All the thumps of the elephant walking and you're feeling it on your chair, no? So again, how can we have something that these like sound experiences can become something interesting and ends up tying my musical background with architecture, which I, of course, I would love to see in the future.
We should try and wrap up fairly soon. I just wonder if there's any final sort of comments to come in here. It's been actually, I get the feeling that we kind of like, we've just opened a can of worms. We thought we're gonna like, we just think, you know, everything's just exploded. And I mean, we finished the last one saying we've got to meet again in 6 months' time. I kind of feel like maybe with Morsel, we've got to meet earlier. But I mean, it's just seemingly something is, I mean, I think what I would want to say is what I've seen today, and I want to emphasize this, is that I'm so pleased to have this group of individuals. I just wish Ross Lovegrove could have been here as well, but he's excused from because he got married, right? But you know what we're seeing with this group of individuals is really history in the making, because this is what's happening with Wanyu developing the software, with Refik pushing it in the media art way, with Patrik doing it in mainstream practice, with Michel coming in from a kind of a different form of practice but still engaging with it, and with kind of people like Chantal and Arturo really and Daniel really pushing the kind of experimental side of things. We're seeing the cutting edge of something that is emerging, you know, and it's so exciting. There's something astonishing that's going on right now, and we're seeing it. So, and to be able to bring everyone together on this platform and share these ideas around the world, that is the most important thing. Because, you know, what I was going to say is that, you know, I had no idea what people were doing. And suddenly you see it, you think, holy shit, this is happening. So this has been an incredible session, just laying it out there and saying, this is what's going on and this is what's going to happen. I could see that this is going to go further and further and further. Maybe Arturo, I could ask you just for a quick comment. You come from a slightly different world, but nonetheless, you've been right at the forefront, especially in the area of your recent kind of collaborations in the world of music and so on.
Well, I have to say a couple of things. First of all, I'm really excited because I started getting into computational design 15 years ago, and there was a huge barrier to entry. Today, at least if we are talking about, you know, the mainstream tools like Midjourney, DALL-E, and et cetera, and Stable Diffusion, I mean, almost everyone can use them. And this kind of democratization is unbelievable, because I'm sure it will accelerate a lot the evolution of tools, but also the way we understand tools. As you said, I'm in this moment, I'm working in so many different fields. Like, to be very practical, I'm working on music stage, watchmaking and also building optimization in the same time in the studio, in the same days. I'm doing different, you know, like meetings on very different words, but in the same time I can see one thing which is very important. I mean, I guess that human beings they have a main ambition, which is like translating our ideas into something physical. This is the common thread. And for the first time, we are exploring a new way to make a dialogue with the machine. Something that happens to me is that the client themselves, they come with me with ideas. So this is the first time in history. In general, clients, they were coming with briefs and very, you know, sometimes subtle or vague indications, but now they come with to me with sketches or pseudo renders, something like that, and I can clearly see this kind of pressure in trying to translating visions into something real. That's the common thread. And for the first time in history, we are not using anymore the muscle memory. Until, you know, 1 year and a half ago, we were creating objects using the mouse by clicking and pushing and pulling points in the computer. For the first time, we are trying to find new ways to create this dialogue with the computer. And that's, for me, is the common thread of all these things. I don't see a particular discipline more attracted or interested. The world of music, but also, I mean, watchmaking, that is really a niche market and very traditional and conservative. They are all looking into new ways, and no one knows how to leverage the potential of diffusion models or machine learning. But it's a great moment, and something that I already said also in this very in Digital Futures is that we were all expecting AI fueling the left side of our brain. I remember it was something really nerdy, right, Daniel? It was super nerdy. And now it's affecting the right side, you know, the creative part. So it's for everyone. And that's really interesting.
Maybe I could invite everyone to kind of just to make a similar comment. Maybe Michel, do you want to kind of, do you follow up?
No. I'm just fascinated about what Arturo is saying. No. But I think, Neil, you have a big responsibility with this group. I just want to throw something there. If you're there's beautiful people that bring creatives together. So this group could be incredible for script writing for future films. This group could be great for decision making in certain government. I mean, again, really. I mean, I think it's a very powerful group from the intricacies of an object to the bigger understanding of how we're making decisions to live in our lives. So so yes, Neil.
Yeah, no, thank you. I'm taking this on board. It's a great point. Refik, do you want to add a comment? I'm just going to try and round things up with some final sort of comments from everyone, but this has been such an amazing session.
Always great to be here with you. Thank you, Neil, for inviting and everyone here. That, I mean, this is just, sometimes history of other disciplines done by, not anymore on a book or like in a class in places that where we connect and virtually, but still share. I'm so happy and honored to be here with you and so inspired this morning. And I'm really excited for another experiment, thinking, sharing. The future is very bright and I'm so excited to be all with you together here.
Wanyu?
Yeah. I want to give some facts. Actually, our platform, firstly, when we reached to 10,000 professional architects users, it took us 1 year back to 2017. But now with our new LookX, it's just less than a month to reach to this same number of the professionals. So we can see today the technique is really evolving and everyone is more accepting this new tech. It's really good, it's really the good moment, let's say. And also thanks for Neil and everyone is pushing the boundary. Otherwise people are still a little bit conservative or they don't really understand what is AI and they kind of afraid of it, but now they really understand more and they want to try more. This is really the thing I think everyone contribute to this professional. Yeah, deeply appreciate.
Daniel?
Yeah, I'm just going to start from a comment that Arturo made about the left side, right side. I don't know how many of you heard of the Moravec paradox. And I think AI is in a way like it, we are in this kind of paradox with AI, like things that we thought that are very hard for machines to solve, like for example, chess and so on, are actually extremely simple for machine to solve. And things that we thought that are very hard for machine to solve is the other way around. Or no, things that we thought that they are simple for us, yeah, are actually very hard for machines, yeah. What I'm going with this is that also when it comes to creativity, I think we go back to the discussion today, AI and creativity. And I think AI kind of challenges a lot of notions that we have about creativity and challenges us to actually think of what exactly means human creativity. Because if the machine can create so easily an image, was that really creativity? Or we have to elevate ourselves now. We have to like think at a different level. Yeah. We have to push things up. Yeah. So yeah, that will be my comment for today. Yeah.
Maybe I just follow that quickly before asking Patrik for his comments. I want to say that there's Stephen Warfel makes this very similar point. If ChatGPT can construct a sentence or can do what it can do on the principle, all it does is basically predict the next word. That's all it does. But out of that, we have this amazing thing happening. And what he says is, does that not suggest that our way of using language is kind of similar, not as complex as we thought it was? I mean, to my mind, it's in the mirror of AI that we can really understand things about what happens here. And that's the amazing thing, as far as I'm concerned, how it can tell us about ourselves, not about AI. Patrik, do you want to jump in there?
Yeah, I just want to mention, I mean, you classified me as mainstream, which is...
Oh, sorry.
No, that's okay. And at the same time, we're still, you know, generating new avant-garde things. So we have a firm where we were rolling out 100 projects and we have 10% of our people R&D. And what starts, the speed by which avant-garde moves into mainstream, and by the way, it has to move into mainstream, otherwise it wasn't avant-garde. is amazing. And we look at one used tool, the way it kind of proliferates and is available and that kind of research continues, but it gets out to everybody faster and faster, which I think is fascinating. It's something where you can't rest on your laurels, where you can't kind of lean back. And I'm just, even just this group here, what we're sitting as here, I mean, last time we were around this kind of virtual table, what all of us have achieved since is pretty noteworthy. So these catch-ups have to become in ever shorter cycles, and we need to feed off each other. But that's what I find fascinating. The speed of development is thrilling.
No, Patrik, I didn't mean that in a negative way. To become mainstream.
No.
I remember going to that to the exhibition in Mexico a while back at the Acadia thing and thinking, wow, you know, all this Azar stuff. But since then, I'm seeing on WeChat and God knows what else, what you guys are producing in China, which is just stunning in terms of its volume. You know, it's important to have an impact on the mainstream.
Absolutely, that's the ambition. That was Azar's ambition, you know, change the world.
I think that is the perfect comment.
Good
on
point.
Which to finish, right? We're going to change the world. We are changing. You guys are changing the world, and we're changing it together. I think this is the most important thing, coming together on this platform. I hope that we can do this again soon. I always sort of say the word computare is a Latin scholar, right? You know, it means to think together. Computation means to think together. And this is what we're getting, this kind of global brain operating, bringing one together. And that's what this platform is so good at. And it's so useful, not just for us to find brainstorming, but also to disseminate, to share that information with everyone else across the globe. That is an amazing contribution. So I just want to thank everyone for their generosity in sharing their thoughts. It's been such a productive session, such an amazing session. Thank you so much for all the presenters. Really, really fabulous stuff. I'm just, my brain's exploding out of all this. I got to also thank the Digital Futures team. We need to get an image of all the people working behind the scenes. It is like an iceberg. There is so much work behind there. So selflessly, all these individuals, thank you so much, Bavlin, Angelica, Gustavo, Michal, and others in the team and so on. It's amazing what we're doing, and we are also changing the world. So let's keep this momentum up. I mean, it's we have to, because the future is upon us, ever quicker. Thank you so much, everyone, and What a mind-blowing session. And tomorrow, Blaise will be with us. If anyone wants to come and join us, Blaise has predicted this all in many ways. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye, guys. Have a beautiful
weekend. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.